What an amazing evening we're about to have for you. It's the 2017 Delaware Athletics Hall of Fame induction ceremony. I'm Scott Klatskin, voice of the University of Delaware Blue Hens, and tonight I'll serve as your MC, and it's always such a great honor to be a part of tonight's event year after year. It's just a phenomenal time recognizing the deep tradition and history of this school. First, I would like to introduce the Director of Athletics and Recreation Services for the University of Delaware, Chrissy Rewa.
Good evening, everyone. Great to see everyone. As Scott said, this is going to be a really fun, I think, and a very special evening. And we are very happy to have past honorees, donors, alumni, family, friends, and of course, the six newest members of our Hall of Fame. I want to take a moment to recognize we have Don Puglisi, a trustee here at the University of Delaware. Thank you, Don, for being with us, as well as Lieutenant Governor Bethany Hall Long. I believe she's with us as well, so appreciate it. And also our former president, David Rozelle, is here, so really special opportunity to have him with us as well. This is a special night, and we are thrilled to have you all here to join us in this celebration. Before we get to the program, I wanted to actually share a little bit about this year's inductees as a class. This year's class features representatives from each decade since the 1940s, which is really cool. Tonight, we will induct our first ever rower in this class. Yes, I think that deserves a round of applause. Four of our inductees are native Delawareans, and five of them currently reside in Delaware. Yeah, also worthy of a clap. I hope that you enjoy learning more about these very special student-athlete alumni this evening. You know, this Blue Hen family is very special, and as I've entered into my sophomore year, I've truly enjoyed it, and the passion and the appreciation and the caring that this community has is unprecedented, and again, it's an honor for me to serve in this role. Before I call Scott back up to the stage to get the program started, I'd like to share this video with you.
In the proud tradition of UD football, few players can match the pass receiving exploits of Courtney Batts. Batts led the Blue Hens to an impressive four-year mark of 38-11-1 that included three straight NCAA tournament appearances, most notably a trip to the national semifinals in 1997, was a two-time All-Atlantic 10 conference selection, and was named the UD Outstanding Senior Male Athlete of the Year in 1998. He also played one season of baseball and led the Blue Hens to an America East title and NCAA tournament appearance in 1995. Courtney Batts. The first ever rower to be inducted into the UD Athletics Hall of Fame, Jenni Buckley joined the squad during its second year of existence and was an immediate standout on the water. As a member of the novice heavyweight eight boats, she led a crew that captured first place in every event it competed in. As a senior in 2001, Buckley was named the team's UD Alumni Association Team MVP as a member of the lightweight Varsity 8's crew that won the Dad Vale title and helped the team capture the overall regatta crown. Jenni Buckley. Whether it was running an open course, competing on the track, or playing with a stick in hand, Sandy Gibney excelled in everything she tried during her career at Delaware. An eight-time letter winner, Gibney was a member of the U.S. National Field Hockey Team and played one season at UD, leading the squad to a 10-4-2 mark. She then made the full-time switch to running and never looked back. Gibney competed twice at the National Cross Country Championships and earned All-American honors. She excelled in outdoor track and field for three seasons and set nine outdoor records during her career. Sandy Gibney. As an outstanding player and well-respected coach, Dan Hammer has played an integral part in the success of Delaware baseball for nearly three decades. Hammer was a standout infielder and led the squad to a record of 158-60, two conference titles, and NCAA tournament appearances in 1995 and 1996. He joined the coaching staff in 1997, and during his coaching tenure, he has led the Blue Hens to 17 winning seasons, five conference titles, and numerous NCAA appearances. Dan Hammer. Over a span of five decades, few individuals have devoted as much time and talent to Delaware athletics than Edgar Johnson. Johnson was a record-breaking swimmer and captain. He joined UD Athletics in 1969 and served in a variety of roles, including head coach. His women's swimming teams won an incredible 42 straight dual meets and placed ninth at the 1981 AIAW National Championships. As athletic director, he enjoyed a distinguished 25-year career in which Delaware captured 10 consecutive America East Commissioner's Cup Awards, won 83 conference titles, and appeared in 32 NCAA championships. Edgar Johnson. One of the most accomplished swimmers in UD history, Art Mayer was a record-breaking conference champion for the Blue Hens. Art didn't begin the sport until he arrived at UD, but quickly flourished in the pool. Mayer set 10 school and 13 pool records and captured four Middle Atlantic Conference individual titles. As a senior co-captain, he became the first UD swimmer to compete at the NCAA championships, participating in the 200 backstroke and 150 IM. Art Mayer.
Thank you, Chrissy, and big thanks to our multimedia department for putting together that great video. Over the course of the evening, we're going to get to know our six honorees who achieved at a very high level, both at Delaware and beyond. They are among the best of the best in the history of Delaware athletics. These inductees have been chosen from a committee of 10 members. At this time, I'd like to give a brief introduction of the 2017 Hall of Fame class. Please stand to be recognized when I call your name. Courtney Batts, football and baseball. Jenni Buckley, rowing. Sandy Gibney, field hockey, cross country, and track and field. Dan Hammer, baseball and associate head coach of the baseball team. Edgar Johnson, men's swimmer, cross country head coach, swim and dive coach, and athletic director. And Art Mayer, men's swimming and diving. Now that we've learned the names, let's get to hear their stories. The format tonight will be two panel discussions. And first, I'd like to bring up the beginning panel, starting with Art Mayer. You get first choice. If you want. No. I joke, but that's technically my seat, Art. Art. When you break as many records as Art did and get inducted into the Hall of Fame, you sit where you want. I'll make the adjustment. Next on stage, Sandra Gibney. And the third member of tonight's panel, the first panel, Edgar Johnson. I'll have to ask Art for my cards quickly, and then we'll get started. If we could, thank you. I'm gonna take my, these were. Oh, no, no, you stay right there, sir. You stay right there, just getting my water. This one, I was eyeing this one up before the evening started. All right, guys and gals, let's get started with this. You know, we saw the videos, and I read a little bit about each person, but again, want to reintroduce and tell a little bit about everybody. Art Mayer, a record-setting championship swimmer from 1949 to 1953. He served as a well-respected veterinarian for over 50 years in Newark, Delaware. Give it up for Art. Sandy Gibney, an 8-time letter winner in field hockey, cross country, indoor and outdoor track and field from 1979 to 1982. Sandy went on to earn her medical degree and now serves in chairman and director capacities at St. Francis Hospital. Sandy Gibney. And Edgar Johnson dedicated time and talent to Delaware as standout swimmer, multiple sport coach, and longtime AD spanning from 1962 to 2009. He began as a record-breaking swimmer and 2-time team captain from 1962 to 1966, then transitioned to coaching, went on to serve as Delaware Athletics AD for an impressive tenure of 25 years. Edgar Johnson. I think everyone here has had in this building today has some type of experience they've taken away from their time at University of Delaware. And this school means a lot to a lot of people in this community, in this building, in this area. So I'll open it up to everyone. What did being a Blue Hen mean for you? Art can go first. We're going to switch mics? Let's switch mics. You're going to have to get close. What's that?
Your question.
My question, Art, is your time being a Blue Hen. What did it mean to you? What did being a Blue Hen mean to you?
Being a Blue Hen means to do your very best to represent your community, your university, and your state. Since I'm a Delawarean, I can do all three of those things, and I accept the challenge throughout my life. And to set example for my kids, my grandkids, and my great-grandkids. They're here.
Yeah, not that.
I started out in 1937 with Uncle Winnie Mayer, who's on the wall, and he took me to a football game on Fraser Field. Delaware was playing, and that was the beginning. He and told me what it meant to be a Blue Hen, a University of Delaware student, etc. And he set my course. I don't think that I ever in my entire life would have gone any other place than the University of Delaware. And starting watching football at Delaware in 1937, I think tomorrow is 1980s, 2017, so that makes an awful long time of watching Delaware football.
Absolutely, we love how the tradition seems to always continue here at Delaware. Sandra, what did being a Blue Hen mean to you?
So I think being a Blue Hen was more than just being a Blue Hen. It meant being a Delawarean. It meant representing the state and being part of a bigger family. I think it's carried on. As you can see, five of us have stayed in the state, and five of us continue to give back to the state. So for me, it's, you know, kind of come full circle that I'm still a Delawarean, I'm still giving back. And that's part of what you learn at Delaware, that it's you learn about getting along with other people and working as a team and really learning life lessons. So there's been a lot of great life lessons that I've learned when I was at Delaware.
Yeah, absolutely. And Edgar, you've been a Blue Hen in many different capacities. So I'll ask the same question to you. Being a Blue Hen, it's got to mean a lot to you.
Well, I don't know when I wasn't a Blue Hen. I can't remember that far back. I'm very proud to be a University of Delaware graduate and to have had a career at the University of Delaware and work with so many fine and outstanding people. More than that, I'm proud that I've met my wife here, my children went to school here, and so the University of Delaware and Blue Hens have been a significant part of my life and now their life, and I think that's important. We have a tremendous sense of pride in this great university. For 45 years, the university used to pay me to say, this is a great place. But if they didn't pay me, I still would say, this is a great place.
Very well said, very well said. And obviously your time as a student athlete led you to the coaching ranks and then the athletic director for 25 years. How did that time as a student athlete, being a part of the school and sports, kind of shape you into the person that you became?
Well, first of all, being a student athlete, it was, to me, the most fun that anybody can have as they grow up and mature. The members of my swim team we're still in contact with each other. We get together once or twice a year, the number of us. We're proud of what we did. And we swam for a great man, as Art swam for a great man, Harry Rostrum. When Harry was alive, I used to call him the living saint. He was a good coach, but he was a better man than he was a coach. And I think having him as a mentor and having others, coaches on the coaching staff when I was an undergraduate, to look up to and to help mentor me, I think helped shape me in becoming the coach I became and ultimately the administrator I became.
And Art, what were your memories of that coach, of Coach Rostrum? You both swam for him, and Edgar had some great things to say about him. What do you remember best about him?
Well, September 1949, Harry Rostrum challenged the freshman class to come out for swimming if they did not think they could swim a mile. At that time, to graduate from Delaware, you had to swim a mile. He said, if you can't swim a mile, why don't you come out for swimming, and I'll guarantee you that when I get finished with you, you'll be able to swim a mile. Since I was a pretty good dog paddler and could go about 10 yards, I took the challenge. I'm not boring you with the results because they're all in the book. Harry next entered my life in September of 1975. I was about 50 pounds overweight, partying a little bit, asthmatic, sort of a physical wreck. I once said I went to pot, and kids all laughed, so we don't use that line anymore. So he said, how would you like to swim? There's this new thing called master swimming, and I'd like to try it. And I need someone to swim with me. And I was really embarrassed. It was Sunday morning, and I felt bad. I says, okay, coach, when do we start? He says, tomorrow morning at 6 o'clock. I'll meet you at Carpenter Pool. Well, here we are, 45 years later. I'm still swimming 5 days a week. Wow. And there he is. Harry has probably saved my life. He was my mentor. He became my friend. We traveled to master's meets all over the country. And he was just a wonderful man. And the other day, I was swimming, and I was sort of meditating. And there was Harry. And Harry says, hey, Art, he says, I got a swimming team up here in heaven, and we're called the Blue Hen Angels. And he said, I'm needing a backstroker. And I said, oh, geez, Harry, I got some things to do. I got to go to university and get an award. So he says, well, take your time. So I go to the locker room, and I'm thinking about this, and I'm laughing. And the guy says, what's funny? And I said, well, I told him the story. And the guy looked at me, and he starts laughing. And I said, what are you laughing about? And he said, oh, he says, you're an optimist. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Now I find out I have a backup. Edgar, this morning at workout, he appeared again, and he says, oh, tell Edgar, I'm waiting for him, and they have a new race. They have a new race now, the 200, the 800-meter backstroke, and you and Wager will not have to race, but you'll have to be together on the relay. So, Wager, if you get there a bit ahead of me, save me a place.
It's going to be a long, long time. What a good story. Thank you, Art, for that. Oh, goodness. Wonderful story, and thank you for sharing. And we're talking about mentors, and Sandra, I know that you've had some great mentors here at Delaware as well.
Yeah, like Edgar, I met my husband here, running cross country and running track and field, and so we've been married 14 years after a 20-year absence. But a lot of my mentors have morphed throughout the years. Actually, Edgar was one of my mentors. Edgar had this thing when we were freshmen in physical education majors, we had to take swimming. And I was a runner by body build and 3% body fat, and I sunk like a stone. But Edgar had this thing that you could get an A in his class if they tied your hands behind your back and they tied your legs together and they put you in the diving pool, which was 20 foot, and all you had to do was dead man float for 6 minutes. And so I thought, that doesn't seem that bad. I could swim a little, but not much. I was probably better than his doggy paddle, but not much. So I said, this can't be this bad. But the blue hen way, like I was going to get an A, and I wasn't going to fail. And so I started like everybody else in the diving well, 20 feet deep, and I'm good. And I got my hands tied behind my back, I got my legs tied together, and everything's good. I'm kind of in a mantra, and I'm thinking it's got to be about 4 minutes now. Now I'm starting to struggle. I'm feeling like I can't really breathe. And Ed goes, it's okay, you just put your head up and take a breath every once in a while. Just put your head up. So I said, all right, I better get a breath. So I look up to put my head up, and I've got 20 foot of water over my head. I'm like, oh, shit. But I got to get an A. So it's like, if I don't stay in here, you could call for help. You could do something. Someone can pull you out, but then you don't get the A, right? So then I'm in this frantic position. My hands are tied behind my back. Legs are tied. So I'm starting to do this whole, like, trout out of water guppy thing to get myself back to the surface, knowing now as a doctor that after 6 minutes, you basically deprive your oxygen of any brain and can develop an anoxic brain injury. Of course, none of us knew that back then. We were all in for the A. So I squirmed my way like a minnow up to the top and was gasping and hung on and stayed the 6 minutes till Edgar said we could get out of the pool. But after that, I pretty much learned, you know what? If I can do that, I can do just about anything, right? And I learned not to quit and not to fail. And so when I started thinking about going to medical school and I'm 27 years old and I'm a woman and people don't do that, and where'd you go? And there was a lot of odds against me at that point, but you know, hey, listen, I got off the bottom of that diving well with my hands and feet tied. So hell if I couldn't make it into med school and do 2 residencies and then come back and serve the state and now be proud to work with the lieutenant governor and the governor and making a difference in the state and be married to a Delawarean. So
there you go. Well,
can I just point something out? Nobody ever did that for 6 minutes. 30 minutes was the time, Sandy. You did have some brain injury.
Seemed like 30.
Before the NCAA deems Edgar ineligible for this award, I'm going to try to move this along and get a hold of this panel. Edgar. You have been an athletic director here, as I mentioned, for 25 years. You served on the Hall of Fame committee, and now you're a part of the Hall of Fame class. And because of your time here, I would think this means an awful lot to you because you've helped people be a part of the Hall of Fame, and now you're a member of this prestigious group. What does this honor mean to you?
Well, first of all, it is a great honor. It's an honor. All the people that have previously been inducted, and the five others that are being inducted today, it is a great honor. But I want to correct you. I haven't helped anybody become a Hall of Famer. They did it themselves. And I'm proud to be inducted along with some of the ladies that were on my swim team that were part of our swim team winning 42 meets in a row. They came in late and I saw them, and I'm happy to join them on the Hall of Fame. The difficult thing when I was the athletic director, people kept saying, you have to have a Hall of Fame. And I kept wondering, why haven't we had a Hall of Fame? And one day I asked Dave Nelson why we didn't have a Hall of Fame. And he said, Edgar, we haven't had a Hall of Fame because we just don't know how to induct the first class. And I thought to myself, that's the reason we don't have a Hall of Fame? We can induct the first class because there's got to be 8 or 10 people out there that are absolutely Hall of Fame caliber that everybody would agree with, and there would be no politicalization of it. And I think if you look at that first class, it was the greats, Bill Murray and Dave Nelson and on, Bob Carpenter, et cetera. These were the greats. And then after that, with so many going back so many years of intercollegiate athletics, there are many, many great athletes that still aren't in the Hall of Fame that hopefully one day they will be and be recognized for all that they've done. But it is a significant honor for me to now become part of the Athletics Hall of Fame because of what has gone before me and what will come after me.
And before we close the panel, I'm sure that a lot of people made big influences on your lives and your lives after University of Delaware and during University of Delaware. We heard about some of them, but I want to give each of you an opportunity to say some thank yous. So I'll start with you, Edgar. Who would you like to thank?
Well, the list is long. Mm-hmm. Do you have time?
We've got plenty. The night is yours to celebrate people on stage.
First of all, Harry Rostrum was a significant person in my life and as my coach for 4 years, and then I coached with him for a number of years. Probably 15 years, I can't remember, but a number of years. And then there are people like the people that I work with and coached with, people like Dave Nelson, Scotty Duncan, Bob Hanna, Barb Vieira, Mary Ann Hitchens, God, my gosh, the workhorse of athletics, Mary Ann Hitchens. So many other great coaches that were here that you work with. It was fun to work with them, and it was fun to enjoy their success when their teams did well. And a coach like Tubby Raymond, I can't tell you how many times I would watch Tubby and how he dealt with people and say, is that something I could use on my swim team and my ladies? And the answer was always, nah, that's, we can't do that. But these people were important and in helping me and setting an example for me as I move forward throughout my career.
I think probably the biggest influence was my mom. She's not with us anymore, but she really made me who I am today. And my husband, who's here tonight, who also is a Blue Hen. And then the people that have supported me all along. And even now, as you said, my neighbors are here that have been my neighbors for years. Good friends at St. Francis are here that have stuck by me and continue to support me. People that have stretched me and pulled me into other arenas besides the arenas that I'm used to being and comfortable being. I have political lobbyists here. Mary Kate is here. I have the Lieutenant Governor here who has stretched me to move beyond and to help the Delawareans and be part of the state movement to help people. So there's been a lot of people that have really, really held me up to do what I could do. And then the people that I worked with here and were teammates of mine, a lot of them that are actually already in the Hall of Fame. Edgar mentioned Marianne Hitchens was my amazing field hockey coach. Janet Smith was her associate at that time, her assistant coach. And then a lot of my own teammates, Carol Miller, who came on to be a field hockey coach here, was a mentor to me. Audie Kuyala, who is also a Hall of Fame member now, and some of the other folks that ended up being in the Hall of Fame themselves for field hockey. And Mary Shelley Nisley, who was a runner and ran with me every day when we worked out here at the at U of D and pushed me to work harder. And I have one last story, but I tell my husband this all the time because he coaches at charter school at Wilmington, and he's always talking about, you know, how some of the kids are soft and the girls are soft and, you know, they don't want to work hard. The girls are like, let's just talk. You know, they don't want to run. So I tell this story that one day Mary Shelley and I went out for a run, and although we liked each other, you know, we were both good runners and we were competitive. And one day she said, you know, Sandy, my knee is really killing me today. And I said, oh, Mary, you're kidding, really? That's a shame. And I'm thinking to myself, I'm gonna bury her. And so, you know, we went out for the run and I buried her. I'm like, Mary, let me get you some ice. That knee must be killing you. Because we were always hurting, you know, and then we'd run into Doc Rylander and plunge in that, like, 30-degree ice bath thing that he would put us in, and then you take a couple of those little pills or whatever that was in Doc's goose juice or something. I don't know. But all those people that were my teammates, they actually ended up being my mentors and the people that I looked up to and the people that I aspired to be, and that has changed as time goes on. But now, like I say, Bethany Hall Long is a mentor for me because she gives back. She's a nurse, she's a professor here. She works every day to make Delaware better. And so, you know, those are some of the people that have really made a difference in my life. And most importantly, my husband and my mother.
Absolutely. Art, the question was, who would you like to thank?
Pardon?
Who would you like to thank?
Who would I like?
To thank. You've had a great journey as a Blue Hen and throughout life. Who would you like to say thank you to?
Well, I would like to thank my family for being supportive. I have two daughters that graduated from Delaware.
I'd like to hear
two
that.
Two granddaughters that graduated from Delaware, and two great grandkids are out there tonight that I hope graduate from Delaware. And I would like to say that my one granddaughter, or my one daughter, swam for Edgar. And I don't know whether Edgar remembers this or not, but the girls' swimming team all showed up with horn-rimmed glasses and mustaches and danced on the end of the pool and sang, and they were known as Edgar's Women. The other thing that I'd like to relate, mainly because of having a chem engineer person on the panel. In my sophomore or junior year, there was an awful lot of fireworks going off on the University of Delaware campus, and the teams would go south and they'd come back with fireworks and all hell would break loose and things were exploding all over the place. And the university did their best to tame it down, but finally in April and May, they just couldn't get a grip on it. And then the student newspaper wrote an article and said that it was a chem engineer that was working on his thesis, and he was known as Louis the Blast. So everybody would wait on Saturday and Friday night to see what Louis would blow up, and always put fireworks in front of Memorial Hall. And finally, the university tracked it down, and they decided it was in Harder Hall, and they found a stash of fireworks. And they told the kids, they said, well, look, neither you're going to turn Louis over or we're going to evict you. And they had some meetings and nothing happened. The explosions kept going off. So they put an ultimatum out. At 2 o'clock, They were going to evict all the students. Somebody called Life magazine, and Life magazine sent their team down, and they showed the students marching, carrying their books and things out of Harder Hall, signs on Harder Hall saying the hall was closed. And it just happened to be Hell Week, and some of the fraternities had all their pledges sleeping in tents all over the campus, so they took pictures of that. And I have that documentation with me tonight, and I'd be glad to share it with anyone that would like to see it.
Well, all right. Thank you, everybody, one more time for Art Mayer, Sandy Gibney, and Edgar Johnson. Thank you, everybody. That was actually the pilot of the late night show Art and Sandy and I have been working on. So hope you enjoyed. Hope you get picked up. We're going to bring up our next three Hall of Famers for the second panel. Please welcome to the stage Courtney Batts. Next to the stage, Jenni Buckley. And Dan Hammer. A reintroduction of everyone. Courtney Batts played wide receiver under Tubby Raymond, who helped lead Delaware to three straight NCAA tournament appearances, a four-year starter who never missed a game, setting an incredible 10 school records. And Courtney currently works in education and serves as an algebra teacher in the Baltimore City school system. Courtney Batts. Jenni Buckley is the first ever rower in the UD Athletics Hall of Fame. She truly defined student athlete, recording a perfect 4.0 GPA, all while studying mechanical engineering, and now serves as an associate professor in mechanical engineering at UD. Jenni Buckley. Dan Hammer, a standout infielder from 1994 to 1996, when he led the squad to two conference titles and consecutive NCAA tournament appearances. He returned to the Blue Hens as a coach in 1997 and is now serving as associate head coach for the Blue Hens, Dan Hammer. I'll open this first question up to everyone sitting here on the panel, and please grab your microphones if you haven't. We're all here again because University of Delaware has made an impact on us in some way, shape, or form. And when you can think back to your time as a Blue Hen, and Dan, you're still a Blue Hen as an associate head coach, how was your time at University of Delaware so special for you? And Courtney, I'll start with you.
We don't want to start with Dan.
Dan, I'll start with you. How was your time at University of Delaware so special for you?
Well, I'm still here, obviously, and my time has been tremendous. I mean, it's become family here for me. Just as a player, it was an opportunity for me to compete at a high level, obviously, and I got to meet a lot of new friends. I still have a lot of good relationships with my teammates from back then. Courtney was one of my teammates for 1 year in 95. Unfortunately, Courtney came after that 95 season. He said he had enough of baseball. He couldn't keep up with schoolwork because of the demands of what baseball puts on our athletes. But trying to stay up with your academics and be an athlete at the same time. But for me, this has just been a great journey. I mean, I 25 years ago, I made a decision. I was actually working at DuPont in Wilmington for 3.5 years. I went to a trade school out of high school. And I made a decision to leave work and come back to school full time and get a degree. And, I was going to come to Delaware regardless of whether I was going to be an athlete or not. So I was playing summer baseball locally, and the guy who I was playing for knew Coach Bob Hanna, who I believe is here tonight. And Coach came to see me play and called me or asked me after the game to come by his office the following week. So I stopped there after work and lo and behold, you know, I ended up a Blue Hen. And it's just been a great journey. And then after I finished playing, Coach Jim Sherman, who's our head coach now and my boss, he convinced me before I finished playing to become, you know, he told me, he said, you know, I think you'd be a good coach. And, you know, and I kind of thought about it for a little bit because I was an engineering sciences, you know, general engineering sciences major here, and had gotten to the point where I wasn't really enjoying the program, and you know, my passion became baseball. And so I kind of took Sherm up on it. And next thing you know, I'm here, and I've been coaching here for 21 years with Sherm. So being a Blue Hen has been just very special to me. So
absolutely. And we're glad that you're still a Blue Hen, and the baseball team doing fantastic. So you're doing a wonderful job with that. And Jenni, you're still a Blue Hen in a different capacity as a professor. And how, talk back on your time as a student athlete and some of those special memories that you had.
Sure. I came here for engineering. Mm-hmm. I'm a product of the public schools locally, very proud product of the public schools locally, as is my whole family. And I came here to study engineering, and I always wanted to continue doing sports. I was a runner and then a biker, and then decided to do another painful sport. It was just painful sport. Oh, there was the wrestling detour. Yeah, that was my family. Be able to be a walk-on on a NCAA team and never have rode before, and then be coached by some amazing people. We had two amazing coaches, Tom and Ann Ellis. Tom is no longer with us, but they took basically, I don't know, six of the nine people in that boat, including the Cox, had never been in a boat before, and turned us into an undefeated novice year boat. Literally, I think we almost flipped it the first time we got in it. And then, you know, our second year developing into a championship lightweight team, I think that really just, Delaware has always really defined opportunity for me. So, and to continue to be a part of shaping people is really important. So I have, I teach freshman engineering and then the senior engineering. The whole process gives me a lot of hope when I look at my seniors, and then I look at my freshmen, and I teach about 850 kids a semester, so wow. I see a lot of Blue Hens and a lot of student athletes, and I think this school means to them what it means to me in a lot of instances, which is it's just an opportunity to find yourself, to try out new things, to flip the boat every once in a while and still be in a safe space, and that's what being a Blue Hen means.
That's a lot of papers to grade, so we won't keep you too long, much longer. I got to get back to that. Courtney, you've had some time. What makes, why was your time at Delaware so special for you?
Well, first and foremost, they gave me an opportunity to, further my education. Mm-hmm. I was given an athletic scholarship to play football, and that's a blessing. I met my wife in the state of Delaware. She went to Goldie Beacom College. I remember meeting Coach Raymond for the first time. He didn't make a home visit to my house. Coach Bob Sable did when they were recruiting me. And Coach Raymond was just quite honest, and I appreciate his honesty. Mm-hmm. On my recruiting trip, I remember meeting my best friend to this day, Darrell Green. And when we left on for that weekend, that Sunday, he said, you coming to Delaware? I'm like, yeah, I'm coming to Delaware. You know, so we hit it off, you know, before we even enrolled. Delaware prepared me to be an educator. It prepared me to be the man that I am today. And I'm thankful for Delaware. I tell everyone, Delaware was good to me. I remember graduating with a 4.0. physical education. Coach called me that summer. My son was just born. He said, hey, we'll pay for two more years if you want to come back and be a grad assistant. And I'm like, wow. You know, and I talked to my wife, like, should I do it? She's like, heck yeah, you should do it. Came back to campus. I remember walking into I didn't have a program. I just said, yep, and packed my bags and came back down to Newark. I wasn't in a program at all. I knew Mr. Roselle really well, and I went to his office. I said, is Mr. Roselle here? They said, he's not here. I said, I'm going to his house. honest to God. I showed up to Mr. Rozelle's house. I hope he remembers this. And I said, I need your help. I said, I need a program to get into. I'm back as a grad assistant, and I don't have a graduate program. He got on the phone. He made a phone call. 15 minutes later, I'm in the Office of Special Education in their program. So I'm thankful for him for that.
Yeah.
And then just lastly, I think about UD every day. Mm-hmm. I talk about UD every day, my experiences, whether it's as playing baseball or my football experiences or my relationship with my friends, my former teammates, my current, who are my current friends now. I talk about UD every day. And even though I don't live in the state of Delaware anymore, I take Delaware with me wherever I go.
Very well said. Courtney, you mentioned Delaware has been very good to you, and you were very good to Delaware. And what I love about this event and just being a part of the community is it's not just a school. It's not just an athletics program. It is a big part of the state of Delaware. And I remember growing up and being taken to Delaware games and how much I enjoyed watching. And I remember watching you play. And boy, were there some great memories and moments in your football career and having Delaware Stadium cheer you guys on and all the wins and tournament appearances. So take me back to your playing days and share a few of your favorite memories from playing as a Blue Hen.
That's interesting. I was recruited to come to Delaware to be a free safety. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the... So one day we're at practice, and there's two instances that occurred that say, maybe I shouldn't be a free safety. One of them was I tried to tackle Darryl Brown in practice, and I bounced off him like a rock does a car. And the whole team just ragged me for like a week, like, ah. The other time was we were in tackling drills, and I don't know if you remember a running back by the name of Lanyu Johnson. Lanyu ran over my entire body. So he started from here. Face mask, chest, everything. But fortunately for me, Daniel Cooper and Keata Malloy were seniors my redshirt freshman year. And when I looked over and see who was coming back, we just had Doug Flowers. God bless Doug. And I said, well, you know, I know Doug. I'll be competing for that position with Doug, so I think I got a good shot. Luckily for me, they recruited a kid by the name of Eddie Conti the next year. So Ed and I, we would try all these pass plays out at practice because, you know, Coach Raymond, we had three pass plays. You had a 5-yard out, a 10-yard out, and a backside keep pass. Basically, you just run that way, right? There was no real kind of... So Eddie and I would just try all these routes out and practice with Leo, you know, post corners, stutters, all kinds of things. And Coach would be like, what the hell are you doing? Do it again! You know, so, you know, just giving us that opportunity to really express ourselves. At the golf outing last year, somebody put it in perspective. He said, you know what, Courtney, you made being a receiver cool again. Because, you know, wide outs at UD just wasn't a popular position. You know, we had run right, run left, run up the middle, and occasionally throw the ball. So I'm just thankful and blessed that, like I said, Coach Tubby, who was very strict and disciplined, allowed me to express myself at practice and in the locker rooms, and I appreciate that.
All right. Jenni, for you, the 4.0, and I know Courtney, you got a 4.0 as well,
yep.
But I wanted to ask Jenni more specifically about hers. In such a hard major, mechanical engineering, it takes a lot of effort to achieve that 4.0. and I would assume that, you know, it's a tight-knit group. You have to be in your studies and
it's not like physical education.
Yeah, there you go. How did being a part of the sports program, the athletics program, allow you to maybe expand and meet some new people and get yourself acquainted with that side of things as well?
Yeah, it's really not a good idea to hang out with engineers all the time. So so it did give me an opportunity to meet a lot of different people. And to be honest, mechanical engineering, which is where I now teach, we have made great progress, particularly at University of Delaware, in the percentage of women who are pursuing that major. And that's a point of pride for us amongst the faculty and amongst the students. We're at about a quarter women. But back in 01 and before that, it was sort of rare. So I had three classmates who were women out of an entire class. And to be on a team, and they're fierce. So Mekki females are fierce, believe me. But there weren't many of us, and to be on a women's team, 50 strong, multiple boats, with a whole bunch of women across all different majors. I wasn't the only engineer. There's one of my teammates graduated as a civil engineer, that was a really special thing. And I'd also be remiss to say, while we're talking about 4.0s, yeah, you better. My longest teammate, honestly, is my brother, who's sitting in the audience right now, who's also a fantastic athlete and graduated 2 years behind me, only by birth order, with a 4.0 in civil engineering. So thanks, Mom and Dad. And is also a tremendous athlete. So there's healthy sibling rivalry. You know, we're talking about rivalry. But
yeah, absolutely. Great family genes that helped out as well. Very smart family and great athletes as well, obviously, here tonight in the Hall of Fame. And Dan, for you, you know, you're seeing it now as a coach, and you're inspiring student athletes now, and you were a player, probably getting some inspiration from people that mentored you. Who are some people that inspired you when you were a player, and if you could share some of your favorite memories from your time, either now or as a student athlete?
Sure, absolutely. I'll go back as far as when I was growing up as a kid. Mm-hmm. Both of my older brothers are in the audience tonight, and one is 7 years older, one's 11 years older. So I used to, you know, sit back and watch those two beat each other up all the time. But they showed me so much as far as athletics, because they were great athletes themselves. And I got a chance to watch them play, you know, different sports for years. And they really mentored me quite a bit as far as my, you know, my athleticism. And, you know, they were always doing things in the yard with me. I mean, it was a tremendous childhood upbringing, you know, and doing all that stuff with them. And moving forward, you know, by the time I got to high school, I met a high school coach named Mel Bacon, and Mel and his wife are in the audience tonight too. And Bake, you know, I can remember the very first tryout I went to for baseball program at Northeast High, and we had to run from the high school down through town in Northeast, which is about a mile or so away, to the Little League fields, because we used to practice all the time on those fields quite a bit in those days. But we went down for a tryout down there, and there was a Little League field behind the firehouse in town. And it had just finished pouring down rain like the day before, 2 days before. So I remember all the infielders had to line up at third base, Bakes hitting the fungos, and there's a huge mud puddle right on the foul line by the third base bag. And the very first ball he hit to me, he hit a line drive that went right over that mud puddle, and I dove right into it. And I was soaking wet, and it was March 1st. It was freezing cold outside. But from that day on, I think Mel appreciated me as a player. And the one thing that he did for me in the 4 years that I played for him was he really instilled a toughness. All the guys I played sports with in high school were blue-collar guys, just really tough competitors in all the sports we played, football, basketball, baseball. And I credit a lot of that toughness to Coach Bacon. I mean, he was a great mentor for all of us. And I think I brought that with me. You know, I continued to play fast-pitch softball. I started playing semi-pro baseball before I came here. So I still tried to stay involved and continue to compete. And then I got here, and, you know, I can't thank Coach Hanna enough for welcoming me into the program here in the fall of 92 as a 22-year-old because I came back late. But he gave me the opportunity that has gotten me here where I am today, and I can't thank him enough. I owe him such a huge debt of gratitude. And then the same thing with Coach Sherman, who's out there in the audience too. He's been a tremendous friend, mentor along the way. I love coming to work and being on the field with him every day. You know, I don't want to get into storytelling because I could write a book on the stories. You know, I could write a chapter on just Coach Sherm. So, and some of the antics and things that he says, but we'll share all that with you. We'll be here all night. But
Sherm appreciates that too.
Yeah,
I'm sure.
So, and then my wife Jenni, who is now Blue Hen, she's worked on her doctoral degree in educational leadership here now, so she's a Blue Hen, but she's probably one of my biggest and most important mentors because I get to live my life with her and watch her and her career and how hard she works, and at the same time trying to be she's being a tremendous mother to our children. She's a loving wife. We've been married for, this will be 16 years coming up. But Jenni and I dated long before we got married. We've known each other for more than half our lives. So, but I want just to be able to wake up every day and watch her go do what she does. I'm very inspired by her. So it's one thing that she's very special in that way. So, and my mother's here in the audience tonight too. And my mother was a homemaker, but my mom, you know, she's the one that gave me the heart I have because that comes from my mom 100%. She's got a great heart. She's very active in the community and has been for a long time. And I really, you know, I really feel like that part of me came from her. So I'd like to thank mom for everything she's done for me. Other than that, I mean, am I mentioning thanks?
Yeah, we can start with, you were able to do some thank yous, and I want everybody to have a chance to say thank you, and if there's anyone else you'd like to give a thank you.
I just figured we could just roll right into that.
Yeah, absolutely.
But
Do you want the chair? Art sat here. We could.
Yeah. No, but aside from everybody I've mentioned so far, my mother-in-law is not here tonight. She's on a trip in Italy, and I'd like to thank her because she's been a tremendous supporter over the years for what I've done, both as a player and as a coach, but she couldn't be here tonight. She was pretty upset about it, but she had planned that trip a long time ago. But there are two other people that I'd like to thank, and they're no longer with us. And one is my father-in-law. He was always one of my biggest fans, you know, ever since I've met my wife. And when I was playing, he was always there, you know, and just a huge fan of mine. So I really appreciated him being around. And lastly, my father. My father taught me so much along the way. The one thing that he really did for me was he instilled a tremendous work ethic. I feel like I have a pretty good work ethic, and that all comes from him. You know, and I really appreciated his mentoring along, you know, regarding that kind of stuff with him. So,
thank you, Dan. Appreciate that, and I'll move along with you know, this is an important night for everyone here, and I want to open up for Jenni and Courtney, starting with Jenni. I know I'm sure there's plenty of people you'd like to thank as well.
Sure, yeah. I mean, rowing is sort of the ultimate team sport, right? You need eight people rowing and a cox to move the boat. So, you know, our accomplishments were team accomplishments. So both my novice crew, the girls I had a privilege of rowing with then, and then the lightweight crew, you know, this is really their accomplishment too. Our coaches, Tom and Ann, are just phenomenal. Ann's just about the scariest person on the planet. I think she smiled twice when we won Dad Vails both times, and that was about it. We actually named a boat after her. We named it the Scary Ann in duct tape, and the boat name stayed that way. So we would win races with the Scary Ann written in duct tape on the side of the boat. She was terrifying. and then my mentors and my professors in the mechanical engineering department at Delaware, who I now have the privilege of teaching with, were huge influences. And then my lifetime coaches are my mom and my dad, and my brother and Nicole and my family, Amy, Galen, Addie, Macy, Connor, everybody who's here. So so thanks, you guys put up, especially the core there. Mom and Dad, Matt, you witnessed 2 years of trying to do mechanical engineering and rowing at the same time, which was not pretty. So thanks for putting up with me then, and to my family, thanks for putting up with me now. So
thank you. And Courtney?
I like to say thank you. I'm going to introduce my family in the room. I'd like to say thank you to my mother, Clarice. Similar to what Dan said, my mother taught me you got to work hard for what you want. Nothing's going to be just given to you. I appreciate that. And amongst other things. My sister's here, my sister Nicole. A lot of people say I have two moms, Clarice and Nicole. But my sister's always been there for me. I tell everyone I have the best sister in the world. Also in the audience, my roommate, Darrell Green, my buddy. He asked me to be one of his best men at his wedding.
Great honor.
I still talk about that.
Did you accept, by the way? You said yes.
I did accept. Okay. I did accept. I'm very thankful to have a guy like Darrell Green. We hit it off from day one, like I said, on our recruiting trip, and here we are, 17, almost 20 years later, we're still best friends, so I appreciate him. Jeremy Tinsley's here tonight. Jeremy did not play football. Jeremy and I grew up in Philadelphia. We've been through everything together. It was September 20th, 1995. Jeremy walks into the football locker room. I'm taking a shower. He walks into the shower to give me some bad news. My brother passed away. I think about that day almost every week of the year. My kids are here, Morgan and Courtney. I got the best kids in the world. We're October babies, so I have a 19-year-old and a 17-year-old. I got started before you, Dan. Kathy Gregory Wade, my mother-in-law, my father-in-law, they've accepted me from day one. I thank you for that. My wife, Danielle, thank you for putting up with me. Thank you for saying yes. I tell everyone I outmarried myself. Similar to Dan, my wife's a realtor, so I don't know if you know any realtors out there, but they're very busy people. And so I'm amazed at how she can schedule appointments with her clients, go up to the kids' school to talk to teachers, prepare dinner, and just hold the house down, and I thank her. If I don't thank you enough, I want to publicly say thank you for being my wife. I just want to make sure I got everybody. I just want to make sure I got everybody in the room. I just want to say thank you to those that I mentioned for supporting me, being there for me in the football stands or back to school night at my school or whatever I need from you. I thank you for your support. So, yeah.
Very well done, all three of you. Congratulations. And thank you so much for being here. Thank you to you three and the three we talked to in the first panel. Once again, Courtney Batts, Jenni Buckley, and Dan Hammer. Please give it up for three. And as our Hall of Famers get back to their seats, I'd like to ask all of the current members of the Hall of Fame to please rise at this time to be honored. Let's give them a big round of applause. Now, at this time, we're going to have the final portion of the program, and I will ask Athletics Director Chrissy Raywalk to come back onto the stage. And we'll bring up each inductee one more time individually to receive their prestigious award. As each inductee receives their award, I'd like you to give them a big round of applause. Courtney Batts. Jenni Buckley. Sandy Gibney. Dan Hammer. Edgar Johnson. And Art Mayer. Ladies and gentlemen, your 2017 Hall of Fame class. And a big thank you for joining us tonight as we welcome these six athletes into this elite fraternity. Congratulations to them and their families. They are truly among the greats in the history of Delaware athletics. Thank you so much for coming tonight, and as always, go Hens!